For a few days, Berlin's Adlon Hotel has become a green showroom. Even at the Berlin Fashion Week, sustainability is an issue. Saruul Fischer designs fashions made from high-quality cashmere wool and markets them under her own label, Edelziege, or Luxury Goat.
When I was thinking about a name for the label, I wanted one that people would remember. There's a touch of humor in the name. We women can be irritable sometimes, like goats, but we're also luxurious creatures and we like to buy quality products. So that's where the name Edelziege comes from.
Saruul, who was born in Mongolia, lives and works as a designer in Plauen, in the German state of Saxony.
You don't have to live in Berlin to make nice things. You can also conquer the world from a place like Plauen. What brought me here was love. I'd barely heard of the place before, but then I met my future husband and it was settled.
Saruul returns to her native land twice a year.
Whenever I come back to Mongolia, I'm so happy that I start to cry. I'm simply filled with joy because it's so good to be back home.
On behalf of the National Flag Carrier
Mad Mongolian Airlines, we would like to thank you for joining us on this trip.
Saruul's love of her homeland inspired her to combine her work and her private life. Her family, including her oldest sister, has come to the airport to welcome her. It's the end of September.
You can't do anything about the weather. We fortune hunters always arrive with the first snow.
It's 8 o'clock, Sunday morning. There aren't many people here on the streets of Mongolia's capital, Ulaanbaatar. You can see that the city is growing rapidly. Saruul's family history is rather complicated.
There are two truths in my life. I came to East Germany at the age of 11 with my parents and my two sisters. A few years later, I learned that I'd been adopted. But I'd actually known my biological parents since I was a child. My biological mother was my adoptive father's older sister. I was sort of handed from one part of the family to another. It's taken some getting used to, but it wasn't a huge shock or anything. It's just something I had to deal with. In fact, it turned out to be a very positive experience. I have a large family with lots of brothers and sisters. I have one family in Germany and another in Mongolia.
It's time for a hearty breakfast. Saruul's brother-in-law, Zadluhu, is happy to see her again.
Just as our little sister flew in from Germany, the first snow of the year started to fall. That's always a good sign. It means that her business will continue to do well and her family will be happy. And that makes me happy too.
Don't feed the pigeons, drones from the loudspeakers in front of the Gandan Monastery. For centuries, Buddhism was practiced in Mongolia, But when it became a Soviet satellite state in the 1920s, religion was suppressed.
Buddhism was banned by the socialist regime. You couldn't practice your religion in public. I remember people doing it in secret.
During the communist period, most of the monasteries were torn down. After the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, Mongolia began adopting democratic reforms, including freedom of religion. Here, Buddhists pray before a portrait of the Dalai Lama.
By European standards, I don't consider myself particularly religious. It's just something you're born into, with your mother's milk, with your food. It's part of your everyday life. It's not forced on you. People practice their religion when they have time or when they need to. I think it's quite natural for people to do this. For example, when women purify their handbags with incense, it's like they're purifying their soul or their spirit.
Just over a million people live in Ulaanbaatar. The capital's main square is dedicated to Chinggis Khan, who founded the Mongol Empire in the early 13th century.
It's a magnificent square. I love it because it's so big. It reminds me of how large Mongolia really is. The square is very symbolic and everyone meets here. You can see our pride in Genghis Khan everywhere. But it's sort of silly that so many things have been named after him. I notice it every time I come back here from Germany. There's Genghis Khan beer, and a Genghis Khan restaurant and hotel. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a Genghis Khan brand of soap, too. My sister and I used to come here and play. We used to swing on those big chains. Here is one of my childhood heroes. It's Suchbater. He liberated Mongolia from the Chinese in the early 1920s. The Soviet Union was our socialist big brother for a long time, but we didn't have too much trouble with that. Compared to East Germans, who didn't want anything to do with the Russians, I never experienced anything like that here.
When the Soviet Union broke up in 1991, Mongolia was left on its own. It began a rapid transition from socialism to capitalism, and this offered exciting new opportunities for many. Still, about one-third of the population lives in poverty today. But in the capital, you'll see many people who are well-dressed and modern.
Ulaanbaatar is a young and lively city. There are lots of young people and lots of contrasts. Most Europeans don't know very much about Mongolia. They think people live in yurts, those big tents, and ride around on horseback. They think it's just a big, wide open space with no houses or anything.
Ulaanbaatar is growing by leaps and bounds, and the construction sector is booming.
You can feel the energy here. There's lots of construction. A lot of new buildings are going up. Sure, it's nice to live in a yurt. They look great, they're traditional, and it's kind of a romantic way to live. But just because you have these romantic ideas, it doesn't mean that you have to spend all your time living in a yurt. It's also nice to have running water and electric lights. Societies have to develop. The old ways won't disappear entirely, but then you've got people paving over a piece of land and putting up a house. People have mixed feelings about that.
Saruul's biological mother lives about 100 kilometers north of Ulaanbaatar in Tief province. Saruul was 18 years old when she found out that she'd been adopted.
This is one of my favorite photos. It was taken on my wedding day. Both of my mothers are there. They got all dressed up for the occasion. Next to them are my two sisters.
When Saruul's in Germany, she's known as Big Sister. But in Mongolia, she's Little Sister, because she's the youngest. She always shows respect for her family, which is a very typical aspect of Mongolian culture.
When I come to visit my mother, the landscape here reminds me a little of the Vogtland in Germany or the Bavarian Alps with the hills and mountains. I'm happy here. It's my home. It makes me feel good. Before I started traveling regularly to Mongolia, I used to have this vague feeling of homesickness. That was natural because I was born in Mongolia. But I think that people are also part of what makes a place your home.
Saruul's mother has lived here for nearly 30 years. Under the socialist regime, she worked as a bookkeeper at a rest home. The government gave her a plot of land.
We started out with 70 head of cattle, 4 horses and 100 sheep. But after my husband died, I just couldn't do all the work by myself. So I sold most of the animals. Now I only have 10 head of cattle. This is our summer home, by the way. My husband and I built it together. Summer is the best time of year for the children and the animals. They need to be outside near the river. Mongolian people move around a lot during the year. It's good for your soul to move around like that.
This is a Mongolian children's song. When Mongolians go off on a trip, people toss a little milk behind them. It's supposed to make sure that you arrive safe and sound and have an auspicious journey. Saruul says she's glad that she has two mothers. And when she returns to Germany, she can tell her adoptive mother all about her latest trip to Mongolia. Saruul was 11 years old when she and her family moved to Germany. she has fond memories of her childhood in Mongolia.
I grew up in this neighborhood. This sports field belongs to the local school. Kids were always playing here. In the winter, they'd cover the field with water to make a skating rink. There used to be a lot of open space here, but now there are more houses. It's really different. There are a lot of cars now, too. Back then, we could play in the streets. I learned how to ride a bicycle here. We jumped rope and played hide-and-seek. See that greenhouse over there? I lived there.
This was a neighborhood for a privileged few. Saruul's adopted father worked for a government ministry.
We lived on the fifth floor, up there where you can see the satellite dish. The five of us lived in a two-room apartment. My parents slept in the living room, and we three kids shared the other room. Well, times have certainly changed. I don't recognize the place anymore. I haven't seen these high-rise buildings before. All you could see back then was sky. We used to take a shortcut by jumping over this fence. This house wasn't here then. The schoolyard seemed so huge back then. Now it looks so small.
Saruul says she was a lazy student and had a tough time getting started in the morning. She remembers that the teachers often used Lenin's famous quote, "Learn, learn, and learn." Saruul knows that many children in Mongolia won't have the chance to improve their lives. Poverty is widespread, and that's why she gets involved in social programs. We visit a local children's home. Ruth Ebener has lived in Ulaanbaatar since 1992. She's a former teacher. Ruth looks after children who are physically or mentally disabled. Many of them are orphans or street kids. The facility is financed mostly through private donations and is staffed by volunteers.
This year we had a volunteer from Germany and one from Switzerland. They just came to help. They also go out into the countryside.
How many kids are here now?
Right now we have 16, including one who just came back from Germany.
Ruth adopted four children here, including Urgi, who's now 22.
I love you.
I love you too.
I wanted to know what their financial situation was. They get little or no funding from the government. Ruth just told me that they have gotten a little money recently.
Saruul wants to do something to help. She has decided to put a link about Ruth's home on her own website.
Good night.
Ruth will care for the children until they're grown up and have learned a trade. We're now about 300 kilometers north of Ulaanbaatar. This is Mongolia's agricultural heartland. This year's harvest is now over. This is the Zeleng region. Saruul's sister's brother-in-law has leased 1,300 hectares of land from the government so he can grow grain crops. He makes a lot of money, but his real pride and joy are his horses.
I like horse racing. It's my hobby. I love to do it more than anything else. I didn't used to have so many horses, but 10 years ago, I started to expand the herd one by one.
A family of nomads looks after the horses. That includes milking them regularly.
They just said that the horses and cows aren't giving much milk right now. Maybe that's due to the weather. And the noise that the herders make? That's supposed to get the milk flowing.
Saruul says she doesn't really like to ride. It's one of those clichés about Mongolia that she tries to avoid. But today, she makes an exception. Here, they're stirring a big pot of fresh mare's milk.
This is the first stage of the fermentation process. It takes 2 hours to brew it, and they have to churn it regularly.
Fermented mare's milk is Mongolia's national beverage. Even Genghis Khan is said to have enjoyed it. It's slightly alcoholic and is supposed to be good for digestion. But for most Europeans, ayrak, or fermented mare's milk, is definitely an acquired taste.
Mare's milk has lots of benefits. It's like medicine. It also tastes good and is good for you. And it has lots of vitamins.
Here's a shepherd with his flock of sheep and goats. Saruul explains why she has a special affection for the goats.
Das sind meine Mitarbeiterinnen.
The cashmere goats are my co-workers, so to speak, just big balls of wool. Here you can see the natural colors of the wool, gray, brown, white, and black.
The soft underfleece grows best in cold weather. At the end of winter, the fleece is combed out and processed to remove impurities. Goats don't produce much fleece. A single cashmere sweater, for example, may contain wool from up to 4 goats.
My work allows me to visit Mongolia so I can combine business and pleasure, but I always do what's best for my business.
Saruul doesn't seem to be interested in the wool of these yaks, even though many consider yak wool a superior alternative to cashmere. It's time now to focus on the business end of the trip.
I drive to Ulaanbaatar early in the morning. The roads are bumpy, which wakes me up.
Saruul is on her way to a knitting mill in the Mongolian capital. She's been working with the staff for years.
In theory, I could have the wool produced in China or Bangladesh, but I don't. I want it produced in Mongolia. First of all, this is my homeland, and I want to keep people working. Second, the wool comes from Mongolia. Third, there's a legally mandated minimum wage here. When I call the mill and someone says that they're working on clothes for my collection, it makes me happy. I have a real working relationship with these people, and it's sustainable. When I come in here, it's like a toy store or a candy store for me. I love looking at all the colors and seeing what the wool looks like before it becomes part of my line of clothing. The material has a special feel and even a special smell. And when I'm back in Germany in my studio, I think of it and feel inspired.
Ich finde, das ist auch so inspirativ.
This young man is programming the computer that runs the knitting machines. He has all the patterns right here in the office. He's developed a lot of new patterns with geometrical figures and plant motifs. One of the patterns is controversial in most Western countries, the swastika.
This pattern is very popular not only in Mongolia, but throughout Asia. It's a symbol of eternity, no beginning and no end. In our language, we call it Tumun. Tumunas, literally 10,000 years. I have mixed feelings about this pattern. I know that on the one hand, the symbol is banned, but here it's a very popular symbol. Different cultures, different patterns. These are two worlds, and there are different feelings about that.
The Mongols were great warriors. They conquered almost half the known world, including parts of Europe. Maybe that's why others use the swastika symbol, because the Mongols were invincible.
Here, Saruul meets with a Mongolian designer to discuss patterns for next season's collection. It's a long way from her first sketches made in Plauen to the final product here in Mongolia. And of course, the design is only really brought to life when a customer starts wearing it. But Saruul knows how to put her ideas across. She has a college degree in communication studies. Saruul, her sister-in-law Oyuna, and brother-in-law Himasan are flying to Mongolia's lake country, about 1,400 kilometers from Ulaanbaatar.
I'm both German and Mongolian, so I may have some very idealistic thoughts about my country. You see the pristine natural landscape, but then you realize that civilization has really encroached on it here. There's a lot of new construction. That's fine, because a country should develop itself. But we also see the same sort of corruption that's found in other countries, particularly in the developing world. Many people in Mongolia are upset about that.
The music blaring from the loudspeaker here at the bus station is coming from an indoor market nearby.
The transition to capitalism has been difficult for Mongolia. People had no idea how to deal with a market economy. I remember that during one of my visits, there was nothing in the shops. people used food stamps. But they learned pretty quickly how capitalism works. Many of them went overseas to get an education. Others took the first steps by getting into commerce. Because Mongolia doesn't really have a manufacturing sector, people decided to start importing goods like food, clothing, cars, just about anything.
Himerson built this market himself, and his wife Oyuna is in charge of renting the stalls.
Does camel's milk taste different from mare's milk?
Sure, and it's good for you when you get a winter cold, but camel's milk isn't easy to find.
Is it difficult to find goods to sell way out here?
It is. The region is close to the Russian border, and a lot of people import food products from Russia. Most of the other goods, clothes for example, come from China, from Beijing.
Oyuna's husband comes from the Ufs region. He studied in Russia and then worked for the government in Ulaanbaatar until the collapse of communism.
I've been running my own businesses since 1991. That's 23 years. I've worked in the sheepskin industry, in agriculture, tourism, and car repair in the transport sector. I've got experience in a lot of different areas.
Since 2004, he's been investing in his home region. That's really important to him these days.
Over the last few years, I've seen a lot of investment in building new roads and improving old ones. People are investing in the extraction of natural resources. That's caused some controversy because a lot of foreign investors are interested, and the government's been awarding contracts to them. But many Mongolians don't want to see so many foreign investors here. It's a touchy subject.
Himerson is interested in investing in natural resources. Mongolia is rich in copper, gold, and rare earth metals. It's time now to relax, so everyone's off to Lake Kiagas, a few hundred kilometers east of Ulaangom. Himerson runs a summer camp here.
Mongolians are very hospitable people. They're also quite curious. They always welcome visitors. You don't have to make an appointment. I don't understand why, in Germany, you have to make an appointment for just about everything, even to see your friends. I tell people they should just drop by, but that doesn't happen very often.
This is the first time Saruul has been here.
This place is pretty remote. It's close to the Russian border, about 1,000 kilometers from Ulaanbaatar. I've never had time to come here, so I'm looking forward to seeing what it's like. It was already dark when we got here, but tomorrow we'll be able to see the lake, the desert, and the camels. But right now, I'm going to bed so I can get up early tomorrow.
The group's hosts are butchering a sheep in honor of the guests.
He's reaching in and opening the aorta.
The first drops of blood are a sacrifice to nature. It's a way to give thanks for our food.
Foreign visitors might find this ritual a bit unsettling.
It doesn't seem so cruel to me. They killed the sheep for food, and they'll use every part of it. That's the way of life here.
This trip to Mongolia has been a real inspiration for Saruul. She's picked up many new ideas for clothing designs.
When I'm in Europe in general, and in Germany in particular, I miss Mongolia's landscape. They don't have these wide open spaces that are so pleasing to the eye. The land is wild and primitive, and that gives a person a solid foundation. You become one with nature. There's nothing artificial here. This land reflects the essence of the nomads who live here.
Saruul's brother-in-law has some camels, and this shepherd is caring for them. In fact, he's looking after several herds.
There are fewer camels here. Look over there.
Oh yeah, there's a lot of them.
They're huge. The humps are hard, unbelievable. But it's amazingly comfortable.
Only a few travelers come here during the summer. The real focus here is not on tourism, but on the animals, which supply wool, milk, and meat. And of course, there are the camel races, which are held every winter. It can get bitterly cold here, sometimes down to minus 40 Celsius. Saruul's hosts have been preparing the sheep for their guests.
Meat is very important for nomads. They can't survive without it. The fat from the meat gives you energy. It can get down to minus 40 degrees Celsius in winter and more than 40 degrees in the summer, sometimes even 60 in the Gobi Desert. In the cold, you need the fat from the meat to survive. You won't find any vegetarian nomads. I'm worried that Mongolia's beautiful and unique natural environment may be damaged once the nomads can no longer follow their traditional way of life. I hope that the changes don't come too quickly and that some thought is put into preserving our culture and environment.
This nearby prayer mound is supposed to bring peace, wisdom, and happiness.
When you're a teenager, you try to fit in with the other kids. You try to look like they do so you'll be accepted. You don't want to stand out in a crowd. But because I'm Asian, people in Germany notice me. I feel pretty much like I'm German, but they see me as a Mongolian. Still, if you can accept the fact that you've grown up in two different countries and two different traditions, it can be quite satisfying. Maybe it's inappropriate for me to say I'm special, but yes, I've finally figured out who I am and where I belong.